You have entered the Command Zone, your destination for all aspects of Elder Dragon Highlander. Enjoy your stay.
You think John Williams would be proud?
He just rolled over in his grave. No, he's still alive, right?
He's still alive. Yeah, my bad. He's rolling over. He's doing something with the baton. Okay. What's up, everyone? How's
George
going?
Lucas just rolled over in his grave.
George is still alive, too.
Mark Hamill just rolled over in his grave.
Yeah, there you go. Alec Guinness rolled over in his grave because he is, you know. Okay, all right. What's up? You're watching
Harrison
Flash
Ford just rolled over in his grave.
Well, in the lore, yeah, actually, now. You're watching / this is the Command Zone podcast. Josh and I love Star Wars. How's it? Oh, hello. My name is Jimmy Wong.
How's it? It's Josh Lee Kwai. All right. We are talking about the remaining 16 solo legendary commanders from Commander Legends. We did the other 16 in the previous episode, so if you haven't seen that and you don't hear the commander you want us to talk about in this episode, it's probably in that one, unless it's a partner commander.
Yes.
In which case, there's 40 of those, and we're going to be doing those in two separate episodes, which will come out later. I'm sure that wasn't confusing at all. Listen, there's a ton of cards in Commander Legends, and you're a commander player if you're watching this show, so you want to get your hands on those cards, and the best way to do that is cardkingdom.com/commandzone. You can pre-order all these cards right now. You can pre-order booster boxes, collector's boosters. You can pre-order the singles, which is the best and most efficient way to spend your money. Just pick out the cards that you know you want from the set and order those from Card Kingdom now, because Card Kingdom is going to ship you the stuff the fastest. They're going to get you your cards faster than anybody else, get them in your hands. The last thing you want is the set releases, and you got to wait a long time before you get your hands on your cards.
Yeah, and there's tons of amazing cards. We're going to be talking about so many interactions today, jam-packed in this outline. And when you get those cards, and when you need to play with them, because you're going to make a deck, you're going to slot some of these cards into existing decks. That's what we're talking about. In the 99 as commanders, you're going to want to put them in. Wow. You can just feel it from the camera. Even though you're far away now and you're looking at them from here, or you're just listening to us, UltraPro makes the best product on the market. And we trust them for good reason. I've used their sleeves in every single situation imaginable as a Magic player in tournaments, for all my Commander decks, for my draft sleeves, and the UltraPro sleeves, they just fit every occasion, whether or not you're going for the art sleeves or the Pro Gloss Eclipse sleeves, which we love to death.
Look at the color on this Araumi right here. This is a Pro Gloss Eclipse sleeve, and the color's so vibrant because they changed the back of the Eclipse sleeve so that they really do allow the colors and the foiling and everything to pop. This is not foil, but yeah, they are really the best sleeves on the market right now, for
sure. And they're consistently made. You're going to get a good product, right? Because it's a bigger company. You know that you're going to get the batches that they make, right? All the sleeves are going to be the right cuts, all that stuff. A lot of those things that we trust UltraPro for, and as well on Game Nights and all of our Extra Turns episodes.
And the final way to support all of our content is directly. If you go to patreon.com/commandzone, you get all kinds of perks, like talking to Jimmy and I on our Discord each and every day. Also, you get to watch Extra Turns and Game Nights earlier than the general public. And when you watch it early, those exclusive premieres are ad-free. And we have two episodes of Game Nights centered around Commander Legends. Sorry, two episodes, one of Game Nights, one of Extra Turns.
Yes.
Sorry, don't quote me on that earlier part. coming out very soon, so join the Patreon right now. There's no better time, because you're going to get a lot of value by seeing those two episodes early. And also, one of the other perks is we shout out one lucky patron every single episode, and this episode is dedicated to Robert Negrete. Robert, you rock.
No regrets.
All right, let's go to Commander Legends Solo Legends Part 2. We already laid out how this is working. We did one episode. There's a bunch more to go. We're also going to do a set review with cards that go in the 99. We might do like a draft primer episode, because this is a set that's meant to be drafted. But for now, let us finish off the 16 remaining solo legends from Commander Legends. That means legendary creatures that do not have the partner mechanic.
Correct. And in each of the color pairings, there are two commanders, except for two of them because of the commander precons. One is uncommon, one's rare, and then there is one of each of the shard and wedges. So we've covered a lot of the shards and wedges. We're going to be talking a lot more about the two color options today. Let's start it off with green-white Selesnya. First up is Hamza, Guardian of Arashin, who is 4, a green, and a white for a 5/5 legendary elephant warrior. This spell costs one less to cast for each creature you control with a plus one counter on it. Creature spells you cast cost one less to cast for each creature you control with a plus one counter on it.
Oh, a little similarities to Animar there.
Yes, that's right. It's the green-white Animar. The main thing it cares about are how many creatures you control with plus one counters on it. It doesn't matter how many counters are on each creature. Unfortunately, I think they made a mistake here. They should have said creature spells and planeswalker spells you cast cost one less to cast.
Oh, interesting.
Because poor Ajani, every single Ajani adds plus one counters either to your entire team or whatever.
But probably doesn't go, or at least you don't want a lot of them in this deck because they can't count towards the mana reduction. Interesting.
But you still are going to play every plus one counters matters card because the idea is that Hamza may always cost just green white depending because, you know, you're going wide. Hardened Scales is a card that works great. And then I wanted to organize this sort of by efficiency. So I think really efficient cards in this deck, Anok Guide is one in the green for a Dog Scout. It's a 1-1, and then when it enters the battlefield, you have two options. You either put a plus one counter on it, so that would count towards Hamza, or you can search your library for a basic land card, reveal it, shuffle your library, and then put that card on top of it. So it actually gives you a little option
if you're stuck on lands.
A lot of times, right, you'll keep a hand that looks a little sketchy, but if you have an Anok Guide in there, that guarantees your third land drop, and you're totally happy to play it. Or later on in the game, it gives you a plus one counter.
It's still a body, too, that can hold a plus one counter later, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Precisely. And just like that, Pollenbright Druid is a card that's very similar, but you can put a plus one counter on the target creature when it enters, or you proliferate. So again, good early, good late, very efficient. Okay. And then we have the Megamorph, because when they flip over, you get a plus one counter on it. And Inox Survivalist gets rid of enchantments or artifacts, and Den Protector gets you back cards from your graveyard.
You witnesses stuff.
The Ozolith, I think, is a perfect inclusion in this deck, because when your creatures die, you're going to want to be able to put those counters back on other things. And again, Hamza wants to go wide, I think. So I put a couple new cards in here that I'm really excited about. One is Basri's Lieutenant. It's a creature human knight with 3/4. It's got protection from multicolor. When it enters the battlefield, put a plus one counter on target creature you control. However, whenever Basri's Lieutenant or another creature you control dies, if it had a plus one counter on it, create a 2/2 white creature token with vigilance.
Oh, nice. And the goal of this deck is really to create a lot of creatures that have plus one counters rather than put a lot of counters on any one creature.
Yeah.
So that could be a lot of value.
And you still play Hardened Scales because when you put those counters on, instead of making all your 1/1s, they become 3/3s, and it's like great. And this is a card that Josh went off with.
And I think it's just going in a lot of white decks now. It's just always good. It's Celadar Retreat. 3 and white for an enchantment has Landfall. And when you hit Landfall, you have two options. You can either create a 2/2 cap beast, or you can put a 1/1 counter on each creature you control.
Oh, for a land.
Yep. And you're in Celestia, so hitting extra land drops with Farseeks and Rampant Growths and thing is a possibility, or you're going to be playing the creatures that pull more lands into play, so it's possible to hit landfall three times.
Make a 2/2, then put a counter on it, right?
It gives you everything
you need to combo off with Hamza.
Yep, it's great.
And then Shalai, Voice of Plenty, also puts counters on everything. Evolution Sage proliferates. Kyathra's Crusade, more plus one counters.
These are the more plus one counter staple type cards.
Yeah, exactly. And then if you want to be like Animar and reduce the mana cost of big creatures, you want to play cards like Dragonlord Dromoka, which just always does work whenever it enters the battlefield because it says your opponents can't cast spells during your turn.
And I remember losing to Melissa DeTora in that card in a very old game nights.
I think in an ideal, like in a fast-paced deck, you can play an Avenger of Zendikar extremely early. You can play a Vorinclex extremely early if you want to
be... For card for jerks.
Yeah. I think this deck, too, can conceivably mill someone out with an Altar of Dementia. It should be able to be built in a way where you're going wide, putting tons of tokens on, and then
if they happen to, like...
Alt win condition, right?
Yeah. If they happen to, like, Glacial Chasm or something, you have a way to still...
Or even if they board wipe, just be like, all right, mill you for 50.
Right.
Or even, you know, close to 100. So that's Hamza. Pretty fun card. It's basically Animar, but for green white.
Yeah, and I like what you said about efficiency early. Like, make sure the 1s, 2s, 3 drops, because that's one thing you learn from Animar, right? Like,
yeah. Oh my God.
You really want to get Animar right out in time, and then you want to play cards in a specific order to get counters on as fast as possible. And Hamza, you want to play those creatures actually before Hamza comes out.
Yeah, you need a lot of creatures.
But you really want to go 1 drop, 2 drop, 3 drop, and somehow they all have +1/+1 counters, and now you can play Hamza on turn 4, maybe, maybe even earlier, depending. So
yeah, play Rishkar, play Jiang Yanggu. All of those cards can add +1/+1 counters.
Oh, Rishkar's so good; makes all of the mana dorks too.
Yeah, exactly.
It's pretty sweet. All right, let's talk about the next one, which is Lathiel, the Bounteous Dawn, 2 green and white, 4 mana total for a 2/2 legendary unicorn with lifelink. At the beginning of each end step, if you gained life this turn, distribute up to that many +1/+1 counters among any number of other target creatures.
Whoa.
So Lathiel says, triggers only on your end step, says how much life did you gain? Well, first of all, says, did you gain life? Mm-hmm. Then says, how much life did you gain? Okay, you can put that many plus one counters, whatever, you know, if you gain five life, it'll be five.
Yeah.
Onto any other creatures. You cannot put the plus one counters onto Lathiel, but you can even put it onto your opponent's creatures. Don't know why you would, but maybe sometimes you might think about it. most of the time, obviously, you're just going to be putting the counters onto your own creatures.
Yeah, and each end step, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, at the beginning of each end step, yeah. So you want to be able to gain life during other people's turns if you want to be able to reliably gain life, right?
Yeah.
So I think one of the first things, I mean, life gain staple type cards, I think are going to go in here, yeah. Like the Soul Sisters.
Yep, that's Soul Warden, Soul's Attendant, and they just gain life when another creature enters the battlefield under your control.
Yep, then there's like Suture Priest, which is very similar, also deals some damage to your opponents. But
against, it's also when a creature enters the battlefield under an opponent's control, yeah, they lose a life. So yeah. Now you're almost playing Aristocrats in Green White.
You usually want the thing gaining you the life to be creatures if possible, obviously, yeah. Because those will be targets to put the counters on. Again, because Lathiel can't put the targets on herself or himself. I have no idea the gender. Authority of the Consoles, another gain life when creatures enter the battlefield.
But this time under your opponent's control.
Which
so,
is
yeah.
great because it triggers on their end step. You've gained life during their turn now.
And it makes them enter the battlefield tapped, which is extremely annoying.
A Johnny's Welcome, another similar effect. And then, you know, other cards that go in gain life decks. So Heliod Suncrown, the new Heliod. This is not going to be a surprise to anyone.
Now you're playing Walking Ballista because there's just an
you may
combo.
As well throw yeah. it in there, right? So
also, Lathiel works really well with Walking Ballista even yeah. if you don't get Heliod out.
So. Yep. So that's just a sort of gimme combo you're probably going to run. Then you want the life gain, staples, and payoffs. Mm-hmm. Well of Lost Dreams, you draw cards for life gain. Aetherflux Reservoir, if you get enough life, you laser beam Death Star people down. Jimmy, you've been on the receiving end of that one.
Yes, unfortunately.
Crested Sunmare, you create five fives if you can gain life.
At the beginning of each end step, so yep. actually this works really well with Lathiel, and they actually almost look identical in terms of what
yeah,
they're
they
doing.
Yeah, they really do. Actually, Crested Sunmare just looks like Lathiel with like different armor on or something.
It's like Lathiel cousin
what?
That is not a unicorn.
This is like how Michael Bay reuses his effect shots.
Yeah, he just paints on more stuff.
He's just like, I use it in Transformers 1, I use it in The Rock, so now I'm going to use it in Transformers 2, and then oh, yeah, I'll use it in Miami Vice or whatever. He didn't do Miami Vice, but you know what
yeah,
I'm saying.
Yeah, the car is blowing up, does look cool no matter what, and in this case, you know, majestic horses leaping to the left.
There's Resplendent Angel, Angelic Accord, they all create... creatures, flyers for you, or angels for you.
And at each end step, too.
Yeah, if so. You gain enough life. And then, of course, there's plus one counter synergy stuff that you want, too. So Hardened Scales goes in this deck. Conclave Mentor is a good Celestia one.
Yeah, that's a new card as well from M21. If one, it's basically what Hardened Scales is, but when it dies, you also gain life equal to its power. So that's another way to trigger end step stuff.
Yeah, it can be the life gain thing. Branching Evolution is the new one from, what is this from?
Jumpstart. Ugh. It's unfortunately extremely hard to get. So just keep this card sort of on the radar. When Jumpstart gets reprinted, go to Card Kingdom and pick it up because it will drop significantly.
And that's a doubling season, but only for plus one counters. Yeah. And then there's Evolution Sage, again, which we already mentioned, which proliferates the plus one counters. So
very nice.
Yeah, I think Lathiel will be a fun, like, you know, stompy type deck, attack with a bunch of creatures. Also probably a little bit go wide like Hamza, but...
You probably put Hamza in the Lathiel deck.
Yeah, honestly. Probably. May as well, because it's probably only going to cost, like, a, you know, the two mana, right?
Yeah.
Most of the time. Yeah.
All right, moving on. We got a pretty interesting one. A real buff boy. It's Jared Carthalion, True Heir, which I think is all the way back to Ice Age is when this lore goes.
Oh, really?
So, yeah, Commander Legends, in the same way that Baron Sangir,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
There's a lot of throwbacks here. He is Naya, so red, green, and white for a 3-3. Human warrior. When Jared enters the battlefield, get a ring. Yeah, just kidding. That was a dumb jewelry joke for a Jared Jewelers.
Oh, he went to Jared.
He went to Jared. Yeah. Okay, so when boom, I think a lot of people, even on the East Coast, are like, I've never heard of Jared before. Okay, so when Jared enters the battlefield, target opponent becomes.
Wait, did you write that one last night? Like, I'm gonna say this one.
No, I just come out thought in about the it. Moment. It didn't come out that great. Okay, when Jared enters the battlefield, this is interesting. Target opponent becomes the monarch, and you can't become the monarch this turn. So you can't play him and then hit the person that became the monarch with a creature or something and get it back. And it says, if damage would be dealt to Jared Carthalion while you're the monarch, prevent that damage and put that many plus one counters on it. So on the surface, this doesn't seem that great. You're giving someone else the Monarch. You can't take it back that same turn. And then you have to deal damage to Jared. Oh, is that a hair?
Kiwi hair on your nose, yeah.
Oh, there's plenty of those.
Yeah.
Plenty more where that came from. And you have to deal damage to him to get plus one counters on. It's like a lot of hoops to jump through for just Jared. So,
and the upside's not that great, right?
Like, no, he just gets bigger.
And he has to be dealt damage, and your opponent's going to be like, fine, I just won't deal him damage because I don't want him to get bigger, right?
Yeah, so I think in the 99, this is a really fun, slightly more casual way to kick off Monarch.
Okay.
You can give it to someone that maybe is a little far behind. It's, you know, it's a very efficient card in Nye. It's just three mana for a 3/3. I think it's really good, actually, in Marith, Will of the Wild, because Marith can, one, create small green elemental creature tokens that can then attack your opponents, or you can ping Jared.
Oh, double the... And so you're in the middle of an attack, maybe, and they don't block, and you're like, ping him four times, put 8/1/1 counters on him.
It's massive, yeah. So you can, like... Marith, I think, and Jared work together well. Nyeth of the Dire Hunt is all about fighting, so that's another way for Jared to get damage done to him.
Oh, that's cool.
So I think he's in a lot of decks. He is a non-bow with Saskia, because Saskia, let's say I make you the Monarch and I choose you to get the extra damage from Saskia.
Yeah.
If Saskia hits the other person and then it deals the damage to you, it won't take the Monarch back, because it's not combat damage. That's the only way to take it back. So Saskia would still have to hit you. So don't think this works with Saskia. Because it doesn't.
Don't think that, everybody.
Don't think that. Otherwise, you're playing the hit yourself cards.
Yeah, I was going to say, this could be a stop hitting yourself type of commander, right? Because
it's got pingers in red and, yeah.
Yeah, once Pyrohemia and things like that, just as pump spells for Jared, basically.
Yeah. Jared. Good old Jared. He's either selling rings or Subway sandwiches.
You know all those people that were mad about Rick being a card in Magic?
Oh, right, right.
Jared's already a card in Magic. Not a bit.
So we also have Brash Taunter, which allows it to fight creatures and has stuffy doll type text. Grothama, All Devouring, is a card that loves to fight other creatures. Blasphemous Act is a really good board wipe with Jared on the battlefield.
13 counters on
yeah,
it.
But,
probably and then, play the Monarch cards too, so that you can, you know, you can't steal the Monarch back the turn that you play Jared, but the next turn you could maybe cast a spell that makes you become the Monarch.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
And now you're attacking with Jared in a situation where you are the Monarch on the turn after you played him.
Yeah, that's a great idea. And
there's the new, like, Court of's, whatever.
Oh, yeah. And people just won't want to block him as well, because they'll most likely lose a creature in the process. And then if you just want to fight Jared to make him bigger, Nature's Way is pretty good. Oh, Nature's Way actually is a one-sided fight spell. So if Jared's already taken some damage, actually it doesn't matter. Jared doesn't care about damage. So you can use any of the fight spells.
Yeah, all the fight spells are good. In fact, you want the ones that don't just punch.
Yeah.
You want the ones where Jared will take damage from it.
Yeah, like Primal Might is a new one that's in Standard. It's X and a green. Target creature you control gets +X/+X until end of turn. Then it fights up to one target creature you don't control. So this card is actually just for green.
Jeez.
A fight spell. Prey upon, right? Which is really great.
But you can also pump the creature.
Pump the creature. And then if Jared does that fight and now he's like a 12-12, you can maybe Voltron someone out. And then Domri, Anarch of Bolas, also does fighting. One thing that I thought was interesting is if you went the prevent the damage route.
Mm-hmm.
So Protean Hydra is a card that if damage will be dealt to it, prevent that damage and you remove +1/+1 counters on it. And then whenever a +1/+1 counters removed from Protean Hydra, put 2x +1/+1 counters on it at the beginning of the next end step. So you could play all these types of cards and then Blasphemous Act, make them really big and all.
They become huge.
Stuff like that, yeah. Seki Season's Guide is this really bizarre one where if damage will be dealt to it, you remove that many counters and you make spirits.
Oh, yeah.
So you can get into some interesting loops because you can sack 8 spirits to return from the graveyard to the battlefield. Phyto Hydra has a similar text.
These are all cards that want to take damage.
They want to take damage.
This is a stop hitting yourself deck, but with green. I've usually played it with Mardu.
And
this is definitely going to be better because it's with green.
Yeah. And all the fight spells are huge here.
But also, you got green.
Yeah, and green.
So you get all the green cards.
Ramp.
So it's going to be better.
Well, ramp.
Card draw.
Who doesn't want some?
And card draw. Who thought we'd be saying that? Anyway.
Vigor as well is the same idea. But this one prevents damage
gives
to all your
ability
creatures.
To everybody.
To everyone. Yeah. And then I put a new category in here. I'm calling it Jesper Hill for Kyle and Jesper. It's just highly efficient removal. And if you're in red and green, you got to play Hull Breach. It's a sorcery that destroys artifacts, enchantments, or artifacts and enchantments.
That's pretty good.
It's better than Decimate.
For 2 mana.
Yeah, for 2 mana, yeah.
All right, let's talk about the next one. It is Araumi of the Dead Tide. I think we mentioned this last episode, but Araumi is going to be the fourth deck that's being played in the Extra Turns episode featuring Commander Legends. I believe Ashlyn plays this deck. Okay, it's one, a blue, and a black for a 1/4 legendary merfolk wizard. And this card features one of the new mechanics from Commander Legends. So you can tap around me and exile cards from your graveyard equal to the number of opponents you have.
Mm.
And then target creature in your target creature card in your graveyard gains Encore until end of turn. The Encore cost is equal to its mana cost. Ooh. What Encore is, you exile the creature card and pay its mana cost. For each opponent, create a token copy that attacks that opponent this turn if able. They gain haste. Sacrifice them at the beginning of the next end step. Activate only as a sorcery. So let's go through this again. You tap Araumi and you exile cards from your graveyard equal to the number of opponents you have. So if you're in a four-player game, part of the cost of activating this ability is you have to have at least, well, I guess it would be four cards in your graveyard.
Right.
Because you're going to exile three of them, one for each opponent, and tap Araumi, and then have one card left that's a creature card that mm-hmm. you're targeting. So there is, like, you're going to have to fill up your graveyard in order to make this work. But then, let's say you've got a Moldrifter in there.
Ooh.
You can pay five mana. You exile the Moldrifter now from your graveyard, and you make a copy of Moldrifter for each opponent. So you'll make three Moldrifters, draw six cards, and then those Moldrifters have haste, have to attack each opponent. So one of them assigned to each of your opponents, and then you will exile them at the beginning of the next end step.
You could conceivably do this on your second main and not have them attack just right. to pay the Encore, but I think generally if it's free damage, if
you're
going to
get rid of them anyway.
Yeah, they're going away anyway.
But there are some tricky ways to keep them, so maybe you would not want to attack with them, or if they're going to die or something.
Sundial of the Infinite. Yeah. We'll talk about that at the end of this one.
Okay, so the first part of this deck, and this is a deck, again, that we've had in the house for a couple of years now because of the playtesting and helping mm-hmm. out. This was one of the ones that I believe DJ from Jumbo Commander built the first version of it. We've tuned it up a little here and there. The first step you want is self-mill, because Araumi needs to not only tap, but mill stuff, but exile stuff from your graveyard. So self-mill, Milliken is a really good card in this deck. You normally want your self-mill on creatures, because again, Milliken, oh, well, let's read Milliken.
Yeah, Milliken is 2 mana, artifact creature, 0/1, tap it, mill a card, add colorless mana.
So that's great, because it's ramp, but also it's putting fodder into your graveyard so that you can exile with Araumi, but also you could conceivably activate Araumi targeting Milliken, make three Millikens, tap all three of them for three mana.
Mill three.
And then that's kind of what you do with them. And that's like, listen, it's not Moldrifter, but it's not the worst thing. And
well, here's the thing. You're milling the exact number of cards Araumi needs at that point to activate. Again, maybe you're going to get a better hit this time as well. So,
and Araumi doesn't cost mana, so if you do that, you kind of gain three mana for that turn, right?
Yeah, it costs two to play the Milliken, but you get three copies, but you gain one mana. And at the very least, you refill your graveyard. Maybe you get something spicier in there for the next time you use Araumi.
Yeah, you're right. I forgot. You have to pay the mana cost of the creature also to target it.
But you still gain the mana, so not bad.
Jace's Archivist is a way to... It's basically Windfall on a creature, right? So
discarding your hand, everyone draws equal to the greatest number of cards discarded this way.
Again, if you make three copies of that and do that three times, you really fill up your graveyard very fast. This is one of the best cards in the deck we've found.
Stitcher Supplier. You see this in a lot of Dredge decks now. It's just black for a zombie, and it's a 1/1. And when it enters the battlefield or dies, you mill three cards. So one card to mill six. Really Nine. Good. Right.
Yeah, actually, it's 18, because here's what happens.
If you get it back with the arrows.
No, because... Encore says sacrifice them at the beginning of the next end step. So Araumi activates and targets Stitcher Supplier. You pay one black. It comes out on the battlefield. There's three of them. You mill nine.
Mill nine.
And then you sacrifice them at the beginning of the next end step.
Mill another
nine. It dies.
Nine.
You mill another nine. So yeah, that's why it's one of the best cards in the deck.
And Araumi, again, only costs three mana. So it's not like it's hard to get this going. You can definitely get it going pretty quickly.
And you really want Stitcher Supplier to be played on turn one so that Arami's are just ready to go, right?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. And then, of course, we keep talking about this card.
It's been an amazing card for us. And I think just in general, again, it's a two mana sacrifice outlet. That by itself, like we said, you would play Ultra Dementia if it just said two mana sacrifice creature.
Yeah, you could at least think about it, right?
Yeah.
But so Ultra Dementia, another card in this deck. And it's one of those like Sir Conrad type cards where we just sort of talk about it every episode. Two mana for an artifact, sac a creature, and target player mills equal to the sacrifice creature's power. So, of course, you're milling yourself. And because you're going to sacrifice the Encore creatures anyway, you just sacrifice them to Ultra Dementia before they go away. Yep. And so now every creature you bring back basically fuels the next activation of Araumi. And also, remember, when you're milling cards off the top of your library, you're milling stuff into your graveyard that are maybe better targets than what you currently have in there to activate with Encore. So it's card advantage in a way too.
Yeah, you definitely want to just keep that train going, because thinking that you're going to mill your best stuff, right? The cards that we're about to talk about in your first few activations.
You want to.
Yeah, you want to. You want to get there as fast as possible.
So yeah, the next stuff is like, okay, well, sure, we've got all this stuff milled into our graveyard, but the really exciting part about this deck is, what are the cool things that I can encore out?
Well, this one kind of won the last game night. Spoiler alert, it's Gray Merchant of Asphil or Gary. So it's 3BB. When it enters the battlefield, each opponent loses X life, where X is your devotion to black. However, when you encore Gray Merchant out, you get three of them. That immediately, outside of Araumi, is six devotion to black. So each player loses six and you gain 18.
Yeah, each player loses 18 and you gain 18 because each one will do six.
Oh, that's right.
And
each Gray Merchant.
It's actually seven because you'll have Araumi out.
That's 21 damage with just Gray Merchant and Araumi.
Yeah, that's 21 life gain. That card, it's ridiculous.
It's 21. Yeah, that's a lot. That's insane. Yeah.
We found that Gray Merchant was like the game winner like very often in this deck. And if you see Gray Merchant ever hit their graveyard, you have to kill Araumi or
exile the
Gray Merchant because you will lose to it.
Jeez.
Yeah, it's nuts.
You also have Massacre Worm, which just is a house. And you don't see this card played too often, but it's 3BB. When it enters the battlefield, creatures your opponent's control get -2/-2 end of turn. And whenever a creature in the opponent controls dies, that player loses 2 life. 3 Massacre Worms, -6/-6, 6 life per creature dead.
Yeah, that's
That's another game winner.
I definitely have died to that in playing against this deck, for
sure.
Oh,
wow, this deck is just... This card is awful. How dare you put this in here?
So... Yeah, this is another card we talk about quite often. It's Agent of Treachery, 5BB for a 2/3, but when it enters the battlefield, gain control of target permanent.
Oof.
And then at the beginning of your end step, if you control 3 or more permanents, you don't own, you draw 3 cards. So here's how this goes.
You get to draw.
Yeah, you get to draw 9 cards, right?
Because they're all
3 Agents of Treachery, steal 3 things, end of your turn. Yes, you have to sacrifice them.
But you order it, so Agent of Treachery, it doesn't matter actually. You just draw. Wow.
So you draw 9 cards as well as stealing 3 things.
Typically, that last line of text doesn't even matter.
No.
But this deck works perfectly with Araumi because of the number 3.
Yeah, as if Agent of Treachery wasn't good enough.
Yeah, and then you've got Vindictive Lich, which when it dies, you choose 1 or more, and each mode must target a different player. So 3 of these on the battlefield for 4 mana now. Target opponent sacrifices a creature, discards 2 cards, or loses 5 life. So each of those you can point a different way and have do different things.
So it's like you lose 15, you discard 6, and you sacrifice 3 creatures, if that's what you want to do.
If you wanted to go, my gosh.
Okay. Yeah, the important thing to note is that dies triggers do work with Araumi because you will sacrifice them. And you can also just attack with Vindictive Lich too, because, well, if you block it, dies too. So
yeah, totally.
So that's like 12 damage plus 15 damage plus 6 cards discarded plus 3 creatures sacrificed. Pretty nuts.
Very scary. And then, of course, you run Panharmonicon to double up all of those triggers. Now Gary will do 42 damage.
Gary wins.
Gary just kills you. Yeah. And then to make sure to keep some stuff around, you will play Sundial of the Infinite, which is a 2-mana artifact. You can pay 1 and tap it to end the turn. You can only do the ability during your turn. As a result, all spells and abilities are exiled from the stack, so you just do this as soon as the dies triggers on Araumi comes up, saying you have to sacrifice the creatures, be like, nah, I'll end the turn.
Yeah, we mentioned Araumi goes in the Obeka deck on the last episode because Obeka is Sundial of the Infinite on a creature. Have we ever talked about Sundial so much? I feel like Commander Legends is to Sundial what Zendikar Rising was to Crucible of Worlds.
Yeah, and Scape Shift.
Not quite that amount, but yeah.
Yeah, definitely. There's a lot more interesting things about ending the turn now than there were before.
I want to say the Araumi deck is very, very cool, very strong, but not like CEDH insane, and a really fun deck. So if anybody
like a lot of flexible play patterns as well, depending on how you build it. You don't have to run Gary. You don't have to do the hardcore win in the same turn. You could just put your favorite blue-black things in there.
Yeah, and Gary's not... It's not like you go infinite with Gary, right? Everybody has to be in the 20s or below for that to really, really do its thing, which I think we're used to cards that can kind of win that. And like I said, you usually can sort of see it coming and try to stop it. They have to get it into their graveyard. So I really like Araumi, and it sits at a really nice power level. It's strong, but it doesn't feel oppressive.
Yeah.
Does a lot of cool stuff.
I feel the same way about Hamza, almost. They seem like, they're fun to build around. You can definitely do stuff with them, and it won't break the game.
Yeah.
Me, I'm going to put Peregrine Drake in my Araumi deck and untap my land 15 times.
That's a good one.
And then I'll play, one of the game winners in black. Any of those. Torment of Hailfires or whatever.
All right, let's go on to the next one.
All right, this is Nymris, Una's Trickster. So this is our second blue-black card now, and this is the rare one. So this is a 1/6 for 3 of blue and a black, 5 mana Fairy Knight. It has Flash and Flying. Whenever you cast your first spell during each opponent's turn, look at the top 2 cards of your library, put one of those cards into your hand and the other into your graveyard. So it's not a draw effect. You are looking at two cards, putting one into your hand, one into your graveyard whenever you cast your first spell during each opponent's turn.
One thing I want to say. This is a 5-mana, 1/6 fairy.
Like, yeah, it's a weird, it's a weird stat line.
Like,
yeah,
super
why
weird.
1/6?
I think so you can flash it and block with it, maybe.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's nice.
It's just like, what a weird stat line. But anyway, I just want to say that first. The whole flash tribal thing or instance tribal thing, they've been playing with more and more. Like, yeah. Encourage you to cast spells on other players' turn and reward you for that. So
they're teaching people how to play at instant speed.
Yeah.
By cards that want you to play at instant speed.
So... yeah, there's a lot of the cards for this deck, and a lot of the payoff cards are newer cards, which I think is good. There's like Wavebreak Hippocamp, which is similar to Nymris. It's 2 and a blue for a 2/2. Whenever you cast your first spell during each bonus turn, you draw a card.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, there's Slither Wisp, again, similar. It's a 3/2 with flash for blue, black. Whenever you cast another spell that has flash, you draw a card and each opponent loses one life. Won't work for instance, just for flash, but still.
Yeah.
Here's an old card, Fairy Tauntings. It's a tribal enchantment fairy. It's 2 and a black. Whenever you cast a spell during an opponent's turn, you may have each opponent lose one life. Basically, this deck is going to be made up of 90% of cards that are instant or have flash.
Yeah.
You're not going to put a lot of just regular creatures that don't have flash, or probably any in the entire deck. Maybe one or two if they're payoff cards.
Instant speed, flash cards, yeah, all that good stuff.
There's Brineborn Cutthroat, which is 1 and a blue for a 2/1 pirate merfolk with flash. Whenever you cast a spell during an opponent's turn, put a 1/1 counter on it.
Oh,
this can
nice.
Get very big very fast.
Yeah. Naiad of the Hidden Coves, as long as it's not your turn, the spells you cast cost 1 less to cast, and it's 2 and a blue. Actually, that's really powerful there,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, instant tribal ramp.
I mean, it could be the difference between, oh, I only have enough mana to cast one spell during this rotation versus 2 spells. Maybe,
yeah, one on yours,
spells.
One on
yeah,
the next player.
Because that 1 mana difference makes a big deal over the long game.
And it could save you 2 mana over 2 spells, right?
So, yeah.
Yeah. Then you're going to want to play a bunch of cheap instants, the Brainstorms, the Ops, the Cantrip types, right? Because you're just getting extra value. Brainstorm plus, look at the top 2 cards of your library, pick one, put one in the graveyard.
And draw. Yeah.
Yeah, it's insane.
One. Yeah, that is really, really powerful.
Oh, this card's really good because it'll trigger Nymris twice.
Yeah, Brazen Borrower, another standard staple. Again, I would wait for this to disappear out of standard before getting it. It's 1 blue-blue for a fairy rogue, but it's got this interesting adventure side to it. So you can cast it for 1 and a blue for an instant, and you return target non-land permanent and opponent controls to its owner's hand. And then you can pay the casting cost of 1 blue-blue to flash in a flying 3/1 that can only block creatures with flying. But that's two... you can use this card twice, basically.
Yeah, you basically draw the best card out of your top 2 cards each time you do that.
Yeah.
So this one card draws you 2 extra cards and gives you 2 triggers on Nymris, basically.
Yep.
Dig through time is awesome, because what's Nymris doing? Putting 1 card in the graveyard each time.
Ah, like you're surveilling, basically.
Yeah.
Any deck that likes these sort of mill payoffs, for sure.
Yeah, so Delve is really, really good, and it's instant speed, so you cast another player's turn. Logic Knot is another one. It's an X spell that's a counter spell, says blue and X, counter target spell unless its controller pays X, but it also has Delve, so you can use the cards in your graveyard to help you cast
it. Very nice, and you're definitely playing that not on your turn.
Yep, then there's things like Snapcaster Mage and
Torrential Gear Hulk,
let you recast things. Oh, these counter spells that untap your lands.
Ah, these are great.
Yeah, so Rewind and Unwind, both counter things and then untap the amount of lands that it costs to tap them. So you just get the Nymris trigger, counter something, and then you're ready to cast another instant on the next player's turn.
Yep. Mystical Teachings is also a great card. It's an instant for 3 and a blue, but you can flash it back for 5 and a black, so you get to cast it twice as an instant, and you can tutor for an instant or a card with flash, notably. So that's
going to be your whole deck.
So basically, now all of a sudden, now blue has a creature tutor in a lot of, which is really cool. So Mystical Teachings is actually secretly, I think, one of the best cards in the deck.
Yep. Portal Mage is one that we've seen on game nights that can do some really funny stuff. It's 2 and a blue for a 2/2 with flash. When it enters the battlefield during the declare attacker step, you may reselect which player or planeswalker target attacking creature is attacking. So you say, oh, I don't want that thing to attack me. It's now swinging at Jimmy. And it also is just a creature with flash that's 3 mana, because this deck is just going to hold its mana open, see what happens, respond, and then the end of the turn, nothing really bad happened. I might just flash in Portal Mage for the Nymris trigger.
Yeah, draw a card.
Yep, exactly.
Mill a little bit.
Yep.
Dream Eater is also a card that has a similar text because it has Surveil on it. So Surveilling, in this case, this card surveils 4. It's a 4/3 flash flyer. You look at the top 4 cards of your library, put any of them in your graveyard, and the rest on top of your library in any order. So Dream Eater comes in, you just get more value. So again, you're putting lots of cards in the graveyard if you want.
And Dream Eater also bounces a permanent.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
So sorry. Yeah, when it enters the battlefield,
it's a non-land permanent
to an opponent controls to its hand.
Yeah,
skipping the good part of the text.
Because you're going to be holding your mana open and just weighing your options, this is, I think, a good spot for some of those larger counterspells. And by larger, I mean higher CMC counterspells that we talk about quite often. Sublime Epiphany, Mystic Confluence, Spell Swindle. These are all good here because those are bad when you pass the turn and nothing...
That's your only option.
And so nothing that you really feel like spending that on really happens and you kind of got to waste it on something bad. Well, this is, in this case, you're like, oh, okay, well, I'll just do one of my other things because they're all instants. And then Spell Swindle, oh, that casts a huge spell. Then, I will spell Swindle that, which gives you treasure to then still have instants open on the other player's turns too. So, yeah.
Then there's a new card, Opposition Agent, which a lot of hullabaloo about this one, but it flashes in and basically steals your opponent's tutors. But again, it's a spell you cast. It's in the colors.
Has flash.
And I think, you know, this deck is literally Nymris Una's Trickster. So you're trying to do a lot of tricky things.
It's going to be a pain in the butt to play against because they're going to have a certain amount of counter spells, removal things. So you're always going to be like, okay, what do they got and what are they going to be able to do to me? One ironic thing I thought while building this deck, this is a deck where I do not think you run Leyline of Anticipation or Vedalken Orrery.
Because everything is just flash already?
Everything should already be able to be cast at instant speed. And when I say everything, I mean like, you know, maybe you've got eight or not, maybe no more than seven or eight cards that don't have flash or instant, I think, in the entire deck. Because you don't need it. You know, you need mana rocks, everything else can be instant.
Yeah. So this is how you play like Josh Lequai without playing Vedalken Orrery.
As I was like going through and putting together the list, I was like, this deck sounds fun. I might build this.
Yeah, it does look really fun. I think I'm still thinking about building Araumi right now, just because I want to encore some stuff out. All right, let's move on to the final card in the three colors that has blue and black. It's the Esper Selection in Nevinyrral, Urborg Tyrant.
This is another old character we've never seen, right? We've only seen his disc.
Yeah, three white, blue, and black for a 3/6 legendary creature zombie wizard. Hexproof from artifacts, creatures, and enchantments. Okay. When Nevinyrral enters the battlefield, create a tapped 2/2 black zombie creature token for each creature that died this turn. And when Nevinyrral dies, you may pay one. If you do, destroy all artifacts, creatures, and enchantments. So Nevinyrral plus a sac outlet or just dying any other way.
As long as you got one open.
Becomes Nevinyrall's disc.
Yeah.
Really exciting.
Is it?
This is definitely a little different. I like the fact that it makes zombies when it comes in, especially if you're sacking creatures to a Phyrexian altar or whatever to get the man to cast it. And you're going to want to play a lot of sac outlets in this deck. But I also think you're going to want to just take advantage of the fact that it's a dies trigger on Nev. So cards like Supernatural Stamina and Abnormal Endurance and Gift of Immortality.
So these first two are instants, Supernatural Stamina and Abnormal Endurance. And they both pump the creature, but what they really do is they say, they give a creature an ability until end of turn that says, when this creature dies, returns to the battlefield tapped under its owner's control. So this is a way to get a bunch of zombies to get Nevinyrral back on the battlefield the same turn that he blew up the disc, right?
And not to mention the disc blows up all creatures and he creates zombies for each creature that died this turn. So if you have 10 creatures around the board, sack Nev, cast Abnormal Endurance on him, pay one, blow everything up, he comes back to the battlefield and maybe makes you 10 zombies.
Yes, exactly. And you can do that at instant speed on your end step as long as your sack outlet is in instant speed.
Untap, go to town.
Yeah, so that's a really powerful interaction. Gift of Immortality, I think, is very, very, very good with Nevinyrral because what happens is this is 2 and a white for an enchantment. When enchanted creature dies, return that card to the battlefield under its owner's control. Return Gift of Immortality to the battlefield, attach to that creature at the beginning of the next end step. So this is a way to just continuously wipe the board because...
It doesn't see the gift.
Yeah. So you sack Nevinyrral, trigger Nevinyrral on the stack. Gift of Immortality is already in the graveyard and blow everything up. And then Gift of Immortality brings Nevinyrral back, and then at the end step, Gift of Immortality goes back on Nevinyrral, and everyone's just like, crap.
Yeah,
because now anything I play, he can just do that again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that seems really, really good.
Pretty cool. And the big thing is that Nev will blow up your artifacts that are board wipes, so it's a little rough there. You're going to have to figure out other ways to get rid of him.
The trick there, too, is if you have instant speed removal, you have to kill Nevinyrral in the interim, so it comes back, and then before Gift of Immortality returns to him on the end step, you get rid of Nevinyrral at that point, and then Gift of Mortality tries to come back and says, oh, the creature's not there anymore. I'll just stay in the graveyard.
Yeah, that's, wow. It's going to be tough to battle around this once they get sort of that combo going.
Feels like that old Child of Alara deck I used to have that would just blow everything up constantly.
With Marchesa. Yeah, exactly. However, there are a lot of ways to make your creatures indestructible. There's Eldrazi Monument, and that's great because it loves to token decks because you have to sacrifice stuff. There's obviously Avacyn, Angel of Hope. Bastion Protector. So there's lots of different ways to give Nev indestructible.
And all your zombies if you have some, things like that, so that it's not Nev, right? Because Nev's going to die.
Oh, right, right, right.
Yeah, Nev's going to die. You're going to activate the disc ability, but you'll have other stuff. And so if you've got a way to give all your creatures indestructible, that's a way that like everybody else loses their creatures, but you don't.
But you don't, yeah. So Flawless Maneuver is the pay nothing for it. If you control your commander, it's 2W for an instant. Creatures you control gain indestructible until end of turn, which is cool. You can cast it, and then you can still sacrifice Nev because that doesn't care about indestructibility, and then your creatures stay alive while everyone else's board blows up.
And then one thing anybody who's played Nev's disc a lot knows is that it conspicuously doesn't say certain permanent types on it because it was created before the Planeswalker card type existed.
Mm-hmm.
So it specifically, Nevinyrral says, destroy all artifacts, creatures, and enchantments. It does not destroy Planeswalkers. So this, in Super Friends decks, you will see a lot of Nevinyrral's disc. It's one of the last places we still see that card because it's kind of a one-sided board wipe. So Planeswalkers are going to be good in this deck. So Elspeth, Sun's Champion, Teferi, Time Reveler.
Ugh.
Teferi, Master of Time,
Ashiok, Dream Render, Narset,
Parter of Veils. May probably throw a Windfall in there because you're in blue. You might as well have everybody have no cards if you're Kyle Hale because he likes to do that.
There are tons of Planeswalkers you can use here. In fact, you could have Nevinyrral ostensibly be a Super Friends commander as well.
For sure.
Or just go full-on Zombie Tribal. Why not?
That might be the best version of Nevinyrral as a Super Friends deck, and then you've got a package of the Supernatural Stamina, Gift of Immortality, and a few other things. And what you're saying is like, I'm going to destroy all creatures, artifacts, and enchantments every single turn, and my Planeswalkers are going to win me the game because they don't get touched by that stuff.
Oh, nice. And we'll talk about these cards later, but there's a lot of cards that like creatures dying, so Pitiless Plunderer, Pawn of Ulamog, those types are great in this deck because you'll get more value out of them. You get mana or whatever when Nev does his big board wipe thing.
Not necessarily a fun deck to play against, but a cool deck. I mean, it's going to be strong, I think.
Yeah, it's definitely strong, and I think it's pretty balanced, I think, all things considered. There are a lot of interesting combos to be done, but you can also interact with it pretty easily.
And Nev costs 6, so it's going to be difficult in those colors. No green colors. Yeah, exactly.
All right, this one has gotten a lot of talk online. It's Blim, Comedic Genius. 2W for a legendary creature imp, 4/3, flying. Whenever Blim deals combat damage to a player, that player gains control of target permanent you control. Then each player loses life and discards cards equal to the number of permanents they control but don't own. So a couple of things happen here. Blim has to deal combat damage to someone. You give them a gift. He is the Rakdosed Christmas imp. And then after all that, after you've given them a permanent, each player loses life and discards cards equal to the number of the permanents they control but don't own. So it doesn't necessarily tie to the cards you give with Blim. If you can find other ways for people to take cards that they don't control, even if someone, for instance, steals Josh's creature on their side of the board and Blim deals combat damage, that counts because it doesn't care if it's given by Blim. So it's sort of like the Rakdos Zedru the Great-Hearted.
So you play all these crazy red cards that like scramble verse and crap that like make everybody exchange permanents, right?
Thieves Auction is a really interesting one. People hate this card, but
hate all these cards.
For 7 mana, you exile all non-token permanents, and then starting with you, each player chooses one of the exile cards and puts it on the battlefield tapped under their control. So if you just start taking everyone else's lands, at a certain point, they'll have to take your lands, and that person might lose like 5-6 life, discard 5-6 cards, and Blender hits them, which is pretty dumb. And then the main part about this deck is just giving people cards that they're not going to want to have. So Demonic Pact is an enchantment that has a bunch of options that you choose at the beginning of your upkeep, and they're all great. You're drawing cards, you're making people discard, you're dealing damage, except for the last one, which is you lose the game.
So you give it away before you get to that part?
Yeah, and then they lose the game.
Give it away, give it away, give it away now?
There are certain ways to stop decks. Nobody? Okay. I love the Red Chili Peppers. And you know what? It is a red hot Blim, because he's on fire.
That's the song we should have sang at the start.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe if we ever do a deck tech around Blim. And then you're going to maybe want to give them creatures like Steel Golem or Grid Monitor, which says you can't cast creature spells. And if the person
is going
off... You
basically give them poisoned apples or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. If the player is going off and you need to stop them, you can give it to them and everyone be like, all right, well, you can swing at me with it. I'm not going to block it. It's just 3 damage. And that person is like, crap, how do I get rid of this? I don't have a sack outlet.
That's why you play Altar of Dimension, all your decks.
Yes, exactly. If you have a way of dealing damage to them directly, like pinging them, which Black, Red, and Rakdos will love to do, give them a Phyrexian Negator, which when it's dealt damage, you sacrifice that many permanents.
And, oh yeah, you're in red. That would be so brutal if you go, boom, here, have this Blasphemous Act.
Blasphemous Act, yeah. Sack for
they lose.
13 permanents. A lot of this depends on if they have sack outlets or not, because if they have a sack outlet, that kind of goes around it. But
well, you can give them enchantments like Demonic Pact or this one.
Yeah, Kolfenor's Plans. 2 black for an enchantment. When it enters the battlefield, exile the top 7 cards of your library face down. You may look at the cards exiled with Kolfenor's Plans and you play lands and cast spells from among those cards. Wow, you're drawing 7 cards for 4 mana? However, this also says skip your draw step and you can't cast more than 1 spell each turn.
That's brutal to give to people.
Yeah, so you could grab this. Let's say you find some land, you find a spell, you cast something with it, and then you just give this to someone else. They only get the part that says skip your draw step and you can't cast more than 1 spell each turn.
So this is basically all the black cards that couldn't go in Zedru.
Yes.
You get to play in this deck. That's pretty
cool. Which is great because Blim, I think Zedru needs black to really have this punch.
Yeah.
Forbidden Crypt, 3 black enchantment. If you would draw a card, return the card from your graveyard to your hand instead. If you can't, you lose the game. And if a card we put into your graveyard from anywhere, exile that card instead. Just give this to something like Bajuka Bog, Forbidden Crypt.
Here you go, Bajuka Bog. Oh, brutal.
Bajuka Bog hit you, give you Forbidden Crypt, pass the turn, I think you lose the game.
Yeah. Brutal. Unless you can cast something and instant speed and get something in there.
Yeah, same idea with Lich's Mastery. When you lose life, for each 1 life, you exile a permanent you control or a card from your hand or graveyard. And when it leaves the battlefield, you lose the game. So they can't even get rid of it. Now they have these weird things that they have to deal with. Null Profusion, 4 black enchantment, skip your draw step. Whenever you play a card, draw a card. Your maximum hand size is 2. So Immortal Coil, you exile some cards, and whenever there are no cards in your graveyard, you lose the game. So just you're giving them lots of cards like this. There are a bunch in black that do similar stuff.
It feels like there's plenty of stuff to give them, but I don't want to rely just on Blim to be giving them the stuff. So you want to make sure that you have like other ways to sort of donate cards to other players.
Yeah, totally.
Or other cards that do that on their own. That's why Thieves Auction is so good. Mm-hmm. You might want like Strionic Resonator to donate 2 things.
Oh gosh.
That kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, and then there's some cards that can add more damage to Blim, like Relic Robber is a new one that when it deals combat damage, they make a 0/1 Goblin Construct creature, and I believe it's a permanent they control but don't own. I believe because they're creating it.
No, when you create a token, it used to be that when you create a token, it was considered the owner of the card that created the token, but now they've changed it so that if you create a token, the owner's considered the player that created it.
Ah, okay. Yeah. Well, at the very least, you can cast the Shiny Impetus then on them, which is an enchantment that you own, but you put it on something that they control. So then they control the permanent, but they don't own it. And Shiny Impetus is the thing that enchants a creature and goads it. So it attacks each combat and anyone but you. And then whenever it attacks, you create a treasure token. So it's a card that we were sort of down on from the Commander products. But again, you're giving them a card that you control, that they control, but they don't own. You actually own it. Same with the Vow of Lightning.
You just give them the Impetus because you don't care.
That's what you would cast on them anyway. Yeah. And same with Vow of Lightning and stuff. So that's just more ways to get that going with Blim, should you go that route. But this card, I think there's a lot of options here.
Double Strike is pretty good too because it's combat damage. So if it hits
Trigger.
Twice, yeah, nice. Exactly.
Good old Blim. That's He's going to cool. cause some funny situations as he is a comedic genius, apparently.
It is kind of funny, I guess.
Yeah.
Dark comedy.
It's very dark, yeah.
All right, let's move on to the next one, which is also Rakdos. This is the uncommon. It's Juri, Master of the Revue.
The Revue is the big like carnival from the set that the Rakdos set.
It's the Rakdos carnival. This looks like exactly where Disco Rakdos is hanging out. Right?
Yeah, definitely.
It looks the same. Let's play Disco Rakdos on screen for the YouTube people. All right, let's go back to showing Juri.
Okay.
Right. It's black and red for a 1/1 legendary human shaman. Whenever you sacrifice a permanent, put a 1/1 counter on Juri, and then when Juri dies, it deals damage equal to its power to any target.
Okay, so this isn't that impressive.
Hard to like get it, because it starts as a 1/1.
Yeah.
So if you, but it's hard to get
mana.
It up.
Yeah. I think you put this in the Korvold deck, which is sacrificing things left and right. You put this in the Judith deck, which is sacrificing things left and right. And you put this in like the Garna deck, which is sacrificing things left and right. So you can get
theme here.
You can get Juri really big and keep pumping him up. It sort of like becomes like a reusable or like a kind of a fun the like removal spell
fling kind of.
Yeah, if you have any, you play all those cards in, or you put it in the 99 of those. Mm-hmm. Timurit as well is a very similar type of deck of card.
Actually, fling would be pretty good maybe if you can get Juri big enough, because it's going to deal the damage from the fling and the damage when Juri dies because you sack it.
Yeah, and you know, there's cards like Lily on the Standard Bearer, which actually would work great with our old Nevinyrral. Yeah, which is a new card, 2 in the black for 3/1 with flash. When it enters the battlefield, draw X cards where X is the number of creatures that died under your control this turn. Same thing goes for Village Rites. It's a new card that you can pay 1 black as an instant to sack a creature and draw 2 cards. So just like good value.
Village Rites is underrated. It's a very good card.
Yeah, it's instant speed too. And we've seen, when you look at this card, you're like, oh, I've seen this before. But you look a little deeper and it's like, oh, it's actually
just
really good.
More efficient than the other versions, yeah.
If you're going the damage aristocrats route with Juri, either in the 99 or as the commander, you're playing Mayhem Devil. You are playing fetch lands because those all count as sacrificing a permanent. Spiteful Prankster is a new one from Jumpstart that does the same thing as Mayhem Devil. Falcon Wrath Noble, Zulaport Cutthroat, Blood Artist.
You get the aristocrat stuff. The idea, of course.
Yeah. And then Pitiless Plunderer. This card, by the way, as an uncommon, just keeps climbing up and up. So if you have cards from Rivals of Ixalan, wherever this is from, check it out. It's an uncommon. You might have a few.
Yep.
It creates artifact creature or artifact or tokens of treasures every time a creature you control dies, so it doesn't care about tokens. Pond of Ulamog will create you more Eldrazi spawns to make mana.
That's Anax. Just aristocrat stuff to sacrifice things, you know, multiple times. Yeah,
it's not that exciting, honestly. Anax Hardened in the Forge, again, if you sacrifice stuff, congrats. Good job.
I mean, if you can sacrifice, you know, 20 permanents to this thing, well, you probably deserve to win the game based on that.
Yeah,
and even that doesn't
exactly
immediately win or anything, so it seems imminently fair.
But I think you also play like the Font of Return type decks in this card. It's 1 in the black. You pay some mana to sacrifice the enchantment and you return up to 3 target creature cards from your graveyard to your hand. So you kind of want to do the Garna Eggs thing where you're just bringing stuff back all the time. Phyrexian Reclamation, yada, yada. You know how it goes. Not too excited about Juri, though.
Yada, yada, yada. Well, I am excited about some of the commanders that are still coming up because we have not talked yet about Simic. So if you want to stick around for some really cool stuff, just hang in tight there because we're going to take a quick break and hear a message from our sponsors. All right, that's it. Ashlyn, your turn.
All right, I cast Rass's Bounty and make 9 treasure tokens. Then I attack Josh with Lannery Storm and make more treasure. Sweet, beautiful treasure.
Ashlyn, are you ever going to spend that treasure on anything?
Never! Pirates should have lots of treasure. I hate spending. Then it's gone.
Look, it's true, nobody likes spending money, but that's why when I'm shopping online, I use the Honey browser extension, and I shop for basically everything online.
Oh yeah, Honey makes sure you aren't spending too much by scouring the internet for coupons and promo codes, and it works on over 30,000 websites.
Yeah, just install the extension and then click Apply Coupons when you're checking out. I saved $20 yesterday on a new shirt.
It's simple. If you have a computer, Honey should be on it. It's free and works with whatever browser you use.
You can get Honey for free today at joinhoney.com/command. That's joinhoney.com/command.
Alrighty, I'll definitely use Honey, but I'm not spending my treasure. Yarr!
Well, in that case, I'm gonna cast Vandal Blast and I'll destroy all the artifacts.
What? Seriously? No!
Yarr. Did I do it right?
Greetings, I am Ulamog, but I'm sure you already know that. People think they know a lot about me, actually. Probably because of my rumbling stomach. And let me tell you, being ceaselessly hungry is no joke. It's kind of my whole identity. But that's all changed now thanks to HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. They've managed to get my hunger under control. With HelloFresh, I get a variety of delicious meals sent right to my door and ready to cook. I used to eat Plains of Existence almost exclusively, but HelloFresh helped me break out of my cooking rut. Yesterday, I made myself salsa verde enchiladas. Muy delicioso! Plus, HelloFresh uses sustainable recycled packaging and helps prevent overbuying, which means I don't hurt the planet and I don't draw the attention of the gatewatch. You can get started with HelloFresh too. Just go to HelloFresh.com/command90 and use code command90 to get $90 off, including free shipping. You'd have to be trapped in a moon to pass up a deal this good. That's HelloFresh.com/command90 with code command90 for $90 off and free shipping. Now, thanks to HelloFresh, the only thing ceaseless is my satisfaction.
Yo, 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 yo!
Howdy, y'all!
What's up?
I greeteth thee.
Good morning, command zone!
Josh, what are you doing?
Oh, hey, Jimmy.
I'm just trying out some new opening catchphrases.
Are you not gonna say how's it anymore?
No, probably not. But it's always good to have options. Like, have you heard of Warby Parker?
Yeah, they're the eyewear company, right?
Right, so I've been thinking, I wear the same eyeglasses all the time, and it'd be nice to have some different options. Problem is, we're so busy, I don't have time to go and wait in line at the eye doctor. But Warby Parker has a home try-on program. You just go on their website, you take a quick quiz, and then you get to pick out 5 different styles of frames, and they send them to you, and you can try them on.
Sounds convenient.
Yeah, and I was super impressed by the quality and style of their stuff too. Plus, trying it on at home is great because my girlfriend got to weigh in with her opinions, which is important because she's the one that has to look at me all the time, you know?
Yes, that is important. Also, I look at you all the time too.
Try Warby Parker's free home try-on program. Order 5 pairs of glasses to try on at home for free for 5 days, and there's no obligation to buy. Ships free and includes a prepaid return shipping label.
Try 5 pairs of glasses at home for free at warbyparker.com/command.
Welcome back to the Commander Solo Legends part two of two. Hot shots, part two. We've got 8 more commanders to talk about, and this is the Solo Legends, of course. So we're going to be talking about Gruul, a little bit of Boros, and then a little bit of Simic.
That's what I'm talking about.
Okay, we have 2 Gruul commanders. The first is the rare. It's Hans Eriksson, son of Eric.
Must be related to Safi, right?
It is, because Eric's daughter.
So yeah. They're probably siblings?
Yep. And in the text here says, nothing could ruin such a fine day, Safi. Oh, it looks like someone's fighting in the background and he's like sniffing a rose. He's definitely a lovable brute. It's a really interesting card. 2, a red and a green for a 1/4 legendary creature human scout. Whenever Hans Eriksson attacks, reveal the top card of your library. If it's a creature card, put it onto the battlefield tapped and attacking defending player or a planeswalker they control. Otherwise, put that card into your hand. So it's a card draw in red and green on attacking. When you put a creature card on the battlefield this way, it fights Hans Eriksson. Hans Eriksson is a 1/4.
So you don't want it to be big because it'll just kill him?
Yeah, but you do want it to be big because that's the point. You want to cheat out some cool, huge things. This is Gruul Town.
True. That's true. If it's a Blightsteel Colossus, you're like, whatever, Hans Eriksson died, but you also died.
Yeah, so there's a few ways to go with this. The first thing is definitely just being very careful with the top of your deck, because when Hans Eriksson attacks, you could just draw a card too, which is great. And 1/4 attacking oftentimes can get through, I think, especially in the early game.
Yep.
So since he's Divining Top, Sylvan Library, and Cream of the Crop, Cream of the Crop, I should have mentioned for our Amareth, the Lustrous deck, review. Because it's 1 green for an enchantment. Whenever a creature enters the battlefield under your control, you may look at the top X cards of your library, where X is that creature's power. If you do, put 1 of those cards on the top of your library and the rest on the bottom of your library in any order. Yeah. So that's really good with Amareth, because you create a permanent that's a creature, and then you almost guaranteed get another creature.
And this one lets you just set whatever Hans is going to bring out.
Yeah, and let's say Hans brings out a huge creature, then you get a Scry 6, essentially, where you only keep 1 on top.
Oh, right, because it'll trigger when the creature comes out from Hans. Nice. Yeah.
And then I think if you're going to actually play... another card called Call of the Wild, which is 2 green-green for an enchantment, and the same activated cost of 2 green-green to reveal the top card of your library. If it's a creature card, put it onto the battlefield. Right. Otherwise, put it into your graveyard. So this is actually doing the Hans thing without Hans there.
Doesn't have to fight Hans either. That's nice.
I think that's what this deck is trying to do ultimately, though, and that's why you're going to want Darksteel Plate.
Protect Hans.
Yeah, make Hans super buff so that no matter what comes out, they'll survive. Vigor, we talked about this earlier, prevents damage, and it'll make Hans bigger.
That's nice.
Yeah, so even if the Vigor goes away, now maybe Hans will actually survive.
Oh, if you cheat Vigor in off of Hans.
Yes, it's wonderful.
Boom.
And then Hans gets there. 6 +1/+1 counters.
And they're both tapped and attacking.
And he becomes, 7/10, and now most creatures won't kill him. So Vigor is one of the, and there's lots of tutors in green that put cards... Creature cards, you know.
Worldly Tutor, Vigor, that's got to be one of the best targets early for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Druid's Call is an enchantment, so once you get Hans to be magnificently buff and indestructible, 1 in the green, whenever enchanted creature is dealt damage, its controller creates that many 1/1 green squirrel creature tokens, if you want to go that route. You would think fogs would be actually really interesting in this deck. However, the only fogs you want are the ones that prevent normal damage. So Blinding Fog was the only one I could find in these colors.
Yeah, if they say prevents combat damage, it's not, Hans is not getting hit by combat damage.
Yeah.
It's a fight spell, basically.
Then what do you put out? You got to bop them. So Atali Primal Storm, obviously, it's one that's just
you
wonderful.
Won't get the trigger, get the, trigger off the first time. The first time, yeah.
Yeah, but it doesn't
still,
matter.
Whatever. You got Atali out. It's great.
This new dragon, Terror of the Peaks. Whenever another creature enters the battlefield under your control, Terror of the Peaks deals damage equal to that creature's power to any target. So if you're cheating huge stuff out, Terror of the Peaks now just blasts someone in the face for 8 or 9. I made this new list called Craig's List, which are cards that I think Craig would appreciate because he would always play these really old cards that I would never have seen before. Yeah,
it's not where you go to buy used furniture or something?
No, definitely not. Okay. Or any do anything sketchy, really. So Craig's List are Craig Blanchett favorites. And Craig, if I'm wrong, please let me know. First is Tongarth, Taurum Hero. I actually thought you could make a really fun just legendary friends. Legendary friends with Hans, yeah. Mm-hmm. This is a 4/4 with Vigilance. It's one in a red to tap it, and it deals damage equal to its power to target creature, and then that creature deals its damage to Tongarth. So this is kind of doing similar what Hans would do. And then there's Kumano, Master Yamabushi, who's 3 red for a 4/4, and for 1 red, it can ping any target. And then if a creature dealt damage by Kumano would die, exile it instead. So it's all about like, ha, we're going to bring out cool legendary cards that fight each other. Craig introduced me to the Caldera set of equipment. So there's Helm of Caldera, Sword of Caldera, and Shield of Caldera. Shield gives indestructible. If you have all three out, congrats, you made Exodia.
Never happens. I've tried it many times.
Yeah. I think actually you play all of the swords in Hans Eriksson. That
definitely Feast
that
and Famine.
Black, that, yeah, that protect him from red and green. Because when that's equipped, then if you cheat that creature out, you really won't get that damage by him. And if you want to keep going with the craziness, you're going to play Murag. Because you're going to get more landfall triggers to get more combat steps.
Yeah, Hans Eriksson triggers when it attacks.
Yeah.
So as long as you've got it protected, extra combat steps are going to be great because you're going to get more triggers off Hans, basically.
Yeah, and just keep throwing stuff out. And then you're going to play your extra attack steps with Seize the Day, Relentless Assault.
Don't forget Shrionic Resonator Engine as well will cheat out extra creatures. Yeah.
Yep. Lethiform, great card.
Okay. Let's go to the next one, which is the uncommon Gruul commander. It's Tuya Bearclaw. 1 red and a green.
We did it to you.
A red and a green. I just won't say the joke. It's a 2/2 legendary creature, human warrior. Whenever Tuya attacks, it gets +X/+X until end of turn, where X is the greatest power among creatures you control.
Wait, X is going to give it to you. Look at this.
X is going to give it to you. Yep. That was the joke I was going to make, but I held off.
I've been waiting for a long time for X to give it to me, and I think Tuya Bearclaw is actually fulfilling that dream.
Yeah, so when Tuya attacks, it gets the bonus based on the greatest power among creatures you control, but that other creature doesn't have to be tapped and attacking or involved in that combat. So you want those creatures that have a high power but a low CMC. So Lupine Prototype is 2 mana for a 5/5. It just can't attack or do anything most of the time because each player has to have no cards in hand, but that doesn't matter. It's still 5/5. Gives Tuya +5/+5. There's Phyrexian Soul Gorger, which is a 3 mana 8/8.
Ooh.
But it has cumulative upkeep of sacrifice a creature, which is a downside, but to sneak in a ton of damage, you could play that as like a 3 mana give to you +8/+8,
yeah.
And then you can just sack the Soul Guardian to itself later. Then like just a really big creature, Malignus is a pretty cool one. 3 red for a star. Its power and toughness are each equal to half the highest life total among your opponents, rounded up. It also says damage that would be dealt to Malignus can't be prevented. But like giving to you 20 power often.
Yeah.
And then this is a really cool one.
Pathbreaker Ibex. When it attacks, creatures in control gain trample, really important for Tuya, and get +X/+X until end of turn, where X is the greatest power among creatures in control. So it's double the effect of Tuya here.
Yeah, basically, like you'd go to combat, you'd attack. Pathbreaker Ibex is a 3/3, so it would give Tuya 3 power, and then Pathbreaker Ibex would say, okay, we have a 5/5, everything gets +5/+5, right?
Yeah, actually, Pathbreaker is a 6/6 at that point.
Oh, right.
So then Tuya sees Pathbreaker and gets +6, so it gets +9 total.
So it doubles it. And that's only if Pathbreaker is your biggest creature. If there's something else, then it would be bigger.
And Red Green loves huge creatures because he plays Xenagos in this deck, which makes things +X/+X when it attacks. So it makes things massive. And then you just go nuts. This is a Red Green bop him in the face deck, right?
Yeah, I think you want extra punch. So Rhythm of War seems really good. It's a way to give +1/+1 counters to creatures when they come in, or haste. Rhythm of the Wild, sorry. Rhythm of War is the new Brandon Sanderson novel. That's why I got mixed up. One thing I think that could happen is like Tuya's out, but nothing else is out. And so they look at it and they go, well, you know, what can you play that's really, really that bad? And then you go, boom, something with haste, attack with both things. Tuya gets huge.
Right.
The Rhythm of the Wild, you know, really helps you and helps you not get countered, obviously.
Yep.
Or if the creature's you know, you would rather have the 1/1 counter to give Tuya a little more punch, so you can do it that way. Kessa Wolf Run.
Gosh, this card just, so much damage out of nowhere.
Yeah, you pump another creature probably because that will also pump
Tuya. Oh, right, and they both can attack ideally that turn.
Teamer Battle Rage gives the double strike and the trample. Then Tuya's going to be really large for that turn that you go off like Phyrexian Soul Gorger, Teamer Battle Rage, hit somebody for a million, and then it's like, I have this huge Tuya sitting here. What else can I do? Maybe you can Fling Tuya. Mm. Maybe you can Chandra's Ignition with Tuya.
Right.
And just really take advantage of, because it's probably unlikely that in any game you're really going to make Tuya over 20 power multiple times.
Yeah.
Chandra's Ignition, boom, and just like have one of those really explosive turns that maybe wins the game or puts you in a position where everybody's so hurt after that you can finish it out.
This deck really is just like, I'm going to give it to you.
Yeah.
how is Tuya going to get in there and just wreck you? Also, when Tuya is massive, you cast Return of the Wild Speaker.
Yep.
Where you draw cards equal to the greatest power among non-human. Oh, no. Tuya's a human.
Oh, no.
She's riding a bear, though. Mm. Where is the bear claw?
Still, you have Phyrexian Soul Gorgers big creatures in there,
you're
right?
Still going to play Return of the Wild Speaker. Yeah. It's one of the best green card draw spells because it's an instant.
It also does pump your
non-human
creatures, too. And a lot of the things you're playing are non-human, so I still think it's good.
Yeah. At the very worst, it's 5 mana, +3/+3 for Tuya to get +3/+3 on top of the highest power or whatever the creature is you control.
Yeah, Rich Card's Expertise draws cards equal to the greatest power among creatures you control, then cast something for free.
Yeah, that's huge, which is great. You could even do that before combat, right? Yep. You could draw a bunch of cards or like 3 or 4 and then pay a big thing that gives to you a bigger buff.
Yep. Traverse the Outlands, search your library for up to X basic land cards where X is the greatest power among creatures you control. So post-combat, Tuya's still around, hopefully. Something like an 8/8 or a 10/10. I'll go get 10 lands for 4 mana.
I can
5
see
mana.
A play pattern where it's like swing at you with Tuya, no one blocks. Like take 8. They're like, fine, whatever. Traverse the Outlands, 8 basic lands. Oh, your next turn's going to be nuts.
Yeah, exactly.
Very scary.
And then similar to... Hans, you want extra turn spells, right? Because Tuya will stack up her triggers over multiple combats. So she attacks, gets +X/+X, then you get an extra combat step with Aggravated Assault or Combat Celebrant's a good one because it has power, so it will aid Tuya in getting bigger.
Morog's really good here too because it gives +1/+1 on each of the
and
attacks.
And it's a 6/6, right?
Yeah. So it's huge.
So then you'd say, okay, and then I untap and I attack and Tuya's an 8/8, gets 6 more power from Morog because it just triggers again.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Morog is +1/+0. Sorry. But it gets massive. Power is what matters here.
Yep. So, extra combat steps. I mean, when they're good, they're good.
Yep. And obviously, if you have a deck that Tuya's good in, if you have like a Xenagos beat them down deck, Tuya just seems like a really efficient 2/2 that comes in that could be massive when it finally doesn't end up attacking. So,
all right.
Red green sort of sticking to the plan here.
Yeah.
Cheat some creatures out, attack big time.
Well, and we're going to see that continue with Boros, who's going to kind of stick to the plans we've seen before type of thing.
Even with 3 different Boros commanders.
Unfortunately, it's too bad in the set made for commander that Boros still just can't seem to break out of its mold here of what it normally does. The first one is Wyleth, Soul of Steel, and this is the first commander we're going to talk about here that's actually not from the main set. This is from the pre-con, the commander product. And I want to make a disclaimer at the start. We don't actually know the full deck list for the commander pre-cons. We've seen the new cards, but not what reprints are in there. So we may mention some cards that actually come in the pre-con. I'm not sure. So Wyleth, Soul of Steel, 1, a red and a white for a 2/2. Legendary creature, human warrior, has trample. When Wyleth attacks, draw a card for each aura and equipment attached to it.
Okay. So very similar to what Akiri does, the new one that Josh has, but this is just on Wyleth. It draws as many cards as things are attached to it. So you're going to play your normal stuff, which is Sigarda's Aid. Aura equipment spells have flash, and they can you can equipment auto-attach. Same with Pure Steel Paladin, which lets you
skip equip cost
if you have Metalcraft. SRAM Cedar Artificer, which will draw on auras or equipments or vehicles.
Then you want to play like little, easy to equip equipment, right? Because the goal is to get Wyleth out and swing while it's carrying a lot of stuff. So you don't want like singular big equipment. You want a lot of little equipment, so you'll draw more cards. Shuko, Bone Saw, Bone Splitter.
Yeah.
Those are cheap and can be thrown on Wyleth a lot.
And you reduce your risk a little bit too if you don't pay 10 to equip something or 5 or whatever and someone blows you out.
Auras work too. That's the thing that makes this quote unquote a little bit more unique, I guess. It's not only equipment. So Griff's Boon, Sentinel's Eyes. There's one called Cho Mano's Blessing. You want to read that one?
Yeah, I like this one. White for an aura flash, enchant creature, and as it enters the battlefield, choose a color, and the enchant creature has protection from the chosen color, and the effect doesn't remove Cho Mano's Blessing.
So you can choose white.
So if someone paths it, you can flash it and protect it, and it gives Wyleth another thing to draw a card off of.
A little dangerous, because if you have like Sentinel's Eyes and they go to path it,
right,
it will make Sentinel's Eyes fall off. But yeah, totally. It's still, like, you still do it, because you'd rather that than Wyleth dies, right?
Yep, and then again, once again, third time in a row, extra combat steps, draw more cards. And in the 99, throw this in your Akiris, throw this in any equipment-based deck. Welcome to Boros. I guess this is what Boros is these days. Relentless Assault, yada yada. Attack forever.
Yeah, you can do the Loyal Apprentice and Breath of Fury combo.
Right.
That gives infinite attack steps, and that's going to win you the game most of the time. It actually might be dangerous with Wyleth, because you might draw yourself out. yeah, it's just an equipment deck. It's not that different than the Akiri deck that I built earlier. In fact, I think Akiri is a little bit more interesting, because it wants you to go a little bit wider with your equipment, where this is like put all things on one thing.
Yeah, and again, Wyleth is just good in that deck, yeah. Right? You don't necessarily have to run him as commander, but if you wanted to, let us know.
All right.
Okay, next up. This was actually interesting. It's Bell Borca, Spectral Sergeant.
This is the one of the three Boros ones that's
yes,
this is doing a little bit something different.
Yeah, because the next one we talk about, it's going to sound like we just talked about Wyleth again. Bell Borca, Spectral Sergeant, 2 a red and a white for a star 5. It's a legendary creature, Spirit Soldier. And it says, note the converted mana cost of each card as it's put into exile. So not just your cards, your opponent's cards. Anytime someone does something to exile a card, note the CMC of it. Bell Borca's power is equal to the greatest number noted for it this turn. So when it goes to someone else's turn, it goes to 0. At the beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of your library. You may play that card this turn. So this is how it works, right? You play Bell Borca, you exile a card at the beginning of your upkeep. Aha, it's a CMC 6. Bell Borca is now a 6/5. But
And then if you play that card, it won't be exiled anymore, and Bell Borca
won't exactly. Be, yeah, exactly. Well, no. It is, right? It's always going to be that power equal to the greatest number noted for it. So you can play the card, you can get rid of it.
Oh, but it only lasts for this turn.
If you exile 20 cards, you find the greatest CMC, and that's what Bell Borca's power becomes.
Is this kind of even if you exile like a card with like Path to Exile?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's any, note the converted mana cost of each card as it's put into exile. So this card's actually really interesting, because by itself, right, 2 a red and a white for Outpost Siege, which is at the beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of your library. This goes in every single Boros deck, potentially, I think, like, because they just need the card advantage.
It's true.
And it could be a bigger creature to attack. So,
is it play the card or cast the card?
What? Oh, you may play the card.
Oh, so you can play lands.
Yeah, it's actually slightly better.
Yeah.
I didn't even think that. So I think this deck plays Pull from Eternity, which is a white instant to return a card that's from exile into its owner's graveyard if you need to sort of rebuy stuff. But the cool thing is you can play a card like Greater Gargadon, because you suspend it for a red, and when you suspend it, it's an exile. It's a 10 CMC card, so Bell Borca becomes a 10/5. The cards with two modes on it, like Boom or Bust, you add the CMC up. Which is actually good for Bell Borca. So if you are able to exile like a Boom or Bust, that is a 8 CMC card there. Oh. Stolen Strategy, Josh's favorite. At the beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of each opponent's library, and then you can cast those spells this turn. You can spend mana on the color. However, Bell Borca will look at all the cards that get exiled and find the highest CMC and attach it to herself.
Yeah, that's really cool how it cares about, it doesn't care what exiled the cards, it just cares about like what cards were exiled this turn. That's cool.
Yeah.
Atali, same thing, very similar.
Atali,
I didn't realize it allowed you, if you cast it, it still remembered the number.
Yeah, it is the greatest number for it equal noted for it this turn. This one's really janky, but I think it's pretty funny.
The heck? Phyrexian Portal, 3 mana for an artifact. You can pay 3:: if your library has 10 or more cards in it, target opponent looks at the top 10 cards of your library and separates them into 2 face down piles. Exile one of those piles, search the other pile for a card, put it into your hand, and then shuffle the rest of that pile into your library. So you get one card at random out of
your top 10. Right.
It's sort of half random, right?
Yeah.
They get to kind of separate into 2 piles, and so you get 1 card out of 5.
And then they exile the other pile. But that other pile has 5
cards.
Because you might not want to give them like the really powerful card in the other 5. But you are kind of choosing them at random. So it's a little janky, but yeah, I think if you wanted to have fun with it, you could do stuff in that world.
That's cool.
Skyship Weatherlight does the same thing, where you exile cards from your library, and you can search for any artifact or creature cards. So Draco is a really good one here. 4 mana gets, 16, I think, is how much Draco costs. and then Belborca becomes a 16-5. And if you do happen to draw the cards into your hand, you can play cards like Blazing Shoal, which is X red red for an instant. You may exile a red card with CMC X from your hand rather than pay this spell's mana cost, and you give a creature plus X plus O until end of turn. So this could just be an instant kill with Bell.
Yeah, you basically, whatever X is, you double it.
Yep.
And put that on Bell's power. That's pretty sweet.
Yeah. Fury of the Horde is 5 red red. You exile 2 red cards from your hand to get another attack step. So that again, right, you can just exile a big red card from your hand. Azor's Gateway. Pretty good in a Boros deck already, because you are tapping it to draw and exile a card from your hand. And you're probably never going to transform it, but that's just another way to get that exile clause going.
That's cool.
And then the combo is Hoarding Dragon. When it enters the battlefield, you search your library for an artifact, you exile it, and then you shuffle your library. And then when Hoarding Dragon dies, you put the exile card into its owner's hand. So then you go find Draco. So 5 mana, get a 16 mana CMC card that gets exiled. Belborca becomes huge. Just do some stuff. And there's Reverent Mantra, which is a similar exile a card from your hand, but this one's the white version of it. And creatures gain protection of the chosen color that you choose until end of turn. So that's another way to get damage in.
And to protect Belborca when they go to remove it. Yeah.
So you're going to want to play, it's a weird deck. And if you could play Gleamax, you would, which is a card that has a million CMC legendary artifact, but it's from Unhinged. So we'll move along.
All right, well, I'm more excited about that than I thought I would be.
Yeah, there's a lot of interesting ways to go about it. I think, again, it's Boros. It's not going to be super competitive, but it will be really fun.
It's got card advantage tied to a commander, like that's not predicated on attacking. Like, nothing on this card says you have to attack to get that card advantage.
Yes, and just having this in a Boros deck is totally fine. Yeah. You're putting an Outpost Siege in your deck that you can play lands off of instead.
That will just do some stuff like be huge.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, totally. So I think Belborca is actually a good design for Boros. It by itself does not necessitate you must be playing equipment to play this deck.
Okay, this next one. Do we even have to say any cards for it, or can we just say all the same cards for Wyleth?
We can almost say all the same cards. There's only one card, I think. Actually, no, we'll just talk about the commanders that this could go into. How about that?
Okay, so this is Rayav, Master Smith. A red and a white for a 2/2 legendary dwarf artificer. Whenever a creature you control that's enchanted or equipped attacks, that creature gains double strike until end of turn. So,
all right.
Very similar to Wyleth. I guess maybe you don't put it seems almost the exact same.
It's almost the exact same. Yeah, this is the uncommon one, so it's not supposed to be as flashy. I'm just gonna read off the commanders that you can play it in, or in the 99, or as commander. So Akiri, Fearless Voyager, that Josh built that deck. Akiri Lineslinger, it's a partner commander. There's gonna be a lot of new partners in the set, so take a look at those old partners. Tiana Ship's Caretaker could be the commander or in the deck. Aurelia the Warleader, all about attacky-tacky, double attack steps. And then Sir Gwyn, Hero of Ashvale, you put Rayav in there because whenever equipped creature control attacks, you draw a card and you lose a life.
And then it'll have double strike too. So
yeah, exactly.
Okay.
All right, good job, Rayav. You are normal.
Good job, you're normal.
Yay.
All right. Let's talk about the next one, which is all this is the precon commander from the second Commander Legends Commander precon deck.
Yep.
Again, we do not know the contents of the deck, so apologies if we talk about cards that are reprinted in that deck. We only know about the new cards. All right, it's AC, Tyrant of Gyre Strait, 4 green blue Simic. So hold on to something, everybody. It's a 5/5 legendary serpent. You may play an additional land on each of your turns.
Mm-hmm.
Always good. We know that. Whenever a land enters the battlefield under your control, you may draw a card.
Okay.
So it's Tatiova plus Azusa.
Yeah, but
it's
Tatizuza. Half Azusa. Tatiova plus Triad of the Elysian Grove.
Plus, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Is it crazy to say that there are almost too many cards in green that say you may play an extra land per turn now?
No, it's not crazy at all. I think we talked about this recently where we don't need any more of those cards. There's already plenty. And so now you're, I think, honestly, probably cutting some.
Yeah.
Are you playing? I don't know.
You're pushing it a little bit. AC, people are talking, right? Is this better or worse than Tatiova? Notably, AC is a May draw. Where Tatiova, you have to do it. But Tatiova, you also gain life. So that works in a lot of strategies where you're playing Aetherflux Reservoir and that sort of stuff.
Tatiova doesn't give you the extra land drop.
Yes. But at that point, at 6 mana in green, need it, right? So that's sort of where this card sits. It's an interesting balance. I think this is really good in Anamar because you could potentially cast it for green and blue. And then you play extra land and you draw more cards. I think if you play this as a deck, you play it with 45 to 50 lands.
Yep.
You play Summer Bloom and you play... all sorts of cards that let you drop tons of lands in and just ramp like crazy.
It's just one of these lands matter decks. You know, what did I say? Something like 40% of players have a lands matter deck, according to that poll I did. And this is just another one.
Yeah, it fits in. I don't think this is the most splashy commander, but I could see, right, in a pre-con that's meant more for players. It's a totally fine card.
Yeah, it's going to be powerful. Like, it's very difficult to build that deck where it's not, like, pretty good, right?
I mean, sad that this card single-handedly is more powerful than Wyleth and Rayav combined, which are two.
And Borca, honestly.
So, Borca might push it over the edge, but three cards to one Simic card is like, come on. That's just Simic for you, though.
That's Simic. Speaking of Simic, we're still there. We got two more Simic cards to talk about. This one's pretty cool, though.
Yeah, this one is cool.
It's Gore Moldrak, Amphinologist?
Amphinologist.
Yep. It's one, a green, and a blue, 3 mana for a 3/2 legendary human scout. You and permanents you control have protection from salamanders.
Ooh.
Not how you thought that sentence was going to end.
Yeah, a color? Fill in the blank, Mad Libs. Salamanders. Ha, you're joking. Wait a second.
At the beginning of your end step, each player who controls the fewest creatures creates a 4/3 blue salamander warrior creature token.
Okay, so Gore Moldrak is giving other people salamanders if they don't have as many creatures, and you have full protection from them, so they can never actually swing at you.
And if you have the fewest creatures, you'll get a salamander also.
Yeah.
But yes, if people have... Whoever's got the fewest, you can be tied, right? If I have one, obviously, because I have Gore Moldrak, and two other players have one, then three of us will create a 4/3 salamander. But those salamanders, you and permanents you control have protection from them.
Yeah, so planeswalkers, too. Mm-hmm. You can't get hit by a salamander. Pretty funny.
I think the thing that you're sort of most commonly going to be able to do with this is take advantage of the first line, which is you and permanents you control have protection from salamanders. A little bit you can play around with, like, who gets the tokens and whatnot, but a lot of that's out of your control based on, like, how many creatures they're playing or and stuff like that. So there's a whole bunch of cards, as it turns out, that will allow you to change the creature type on other creatures out there, which means that you can be like, that thing you've got, that's a salamander, so I'm not scared of it.
So Lathiel Colossus, salamander. Yeah,
that's a salamander. So let's walk through some of these cards that do stuff like this.
Unnatural Selection, one in the blue for an enchantment. You can pay one to choose a creature type other than wall. Target creature becomes that type until end of turn. So salamander, viable option.
Peer Pressure, 3 and a blue for a sorcery. Choose a creature type. If you control more creatures of that type than each other player, you gain control of all creatures of that type. This is a way to maybe steal a bunch of, you know, a few of the salamanders.
Peer Pressure and a natural selection. Yes, you could boom. Steal a ton of stuff.
Oh, Gore Moldrak's a salamander. One of my other creatures is a salamander. I've got three. You all have only one or two. I steal them all.
Yeah, and this effect lasts indefinitely, so you perma-steal them.
Yep.
Standardized, blue, and instant. Choose a creature type other than wall. Each creature becomes that type until end of turn. Hold on. Standardized plus Peer Pressure is steal the entire board.
Yep.
Party.
Amoeboid Changeling is 1 and a blue for a 1/1 shapeshifter. It's all creature types because it's a changeling. You can tap it and target creature gains all creature types until end of turn. That will include salamander.
Very nice.
And then you can also tap it and target creature loses all creature types until end of turn. You probably don't want to do that one, but yeah, anything scary, you're like, that's a salamander.
Yeah, and our on Amiibo changeling is just very meme-worthy. Image Crafter, it's a creature for 1/1 for a blue. You can tap to choose a creature type other than wall. Target creature becomes that type until end of turn. Misform Mutants, same idea. It's 4 blue-blue for a mutant, but you play 1 in the blue and just turn creatures into creature types.
Then I think Coat of Arms is like really good in this deck because if there's a bunch of salamanders and you can kind of control the number of salamanders by turning things into salamanders.
Right.
And you've got protection from salamanders, and then you're like,
Coat you can of make their salamanders huge to attack other people.
Yeah, so Coat of Arms is 5 mana for an artifact. Each creature gets +1/+1 for each other creature on the battlefield that shares at least one creature type with it. So if... You know, there's 3 salamanders. They all get +3/+3.
Standardize. Make them all salamanders.
Yeah, but you've got protection from it. And also, you can change other things into salamanders to pump creatures when necessary when they're swinging at people. Pretty interesting.
Yeah, I think Coat of Arms plus Standardize makes everything salamanders, and then boom, just go nuts. So, yep. Gore Moldrak, interesting card. I would love to see some people build around this. This, again, I like the area that this is in, right? This is like a good, interesting build around area, I think, for commanders. They haven't had full on hits out of the park for all of the cards in this set, but I think a lot of the commanders we've talked about has piqued my interest in a lot of ways that standard sets have not.
One more thing I want to say about Gore Moldrak, because I don't think that's enough of a plan, right?
Yeah.
The salamanders thing. I think the second part of that plan could be maybe like planeswalkers, because remember, your permanents have protection from salamanders also. So the way that we usually get rid of planeswalkers in commander is team up and attack them.
Right.
But if you can, you know, have Gore Moldrak out and you can say, what are you attacking? You're attacking my Teferi? Okay, well, I'm going to turn that thing into a salamander. And it makes it a lot harder to remove your planeswalker. So this is kind of, could be planeswalker protection.
Okay, cool. Salamander protection.
No, you're not protecting the salamanders. You're protecting things from the salamanders.
Right.
Yeah.
But they all kind of bounce off so everyone survives, right? If they try and attack you.
No, it doesn't matter. You just don't take any damage. You don't even have to block.
Perfect. All right, our last card is Emoti, Celebrant of Bounty. 3, a green and a blue. Kind of doing a Prophet Krufix thing in here.
Mm-hmm.
It's a 3/1 legendary creature Naga Druid with Cascade. So when you cast a spell, you exile cards from the top of your library until you exile a non-land card that costs less, and you may cast it without paying its mana cost. Spells you cast with converted mana cost 6 or greater have Cascade. Ooh, this is interesting.
Yeah, see, it's a tough type of deck to build because you want to cast high CMC spells, right?
Right.
But if you're deck is chock full of 6+ CMC spells, it's just going to not do anything a lot of times in the early game. So I think what you want to do is find a bunch of spells whose CMC is higher than what you actually pay for it.
Okay. So Allosaurus Rider, which is typically a 5 green card, but you can exile 2 green cards rather than pay its mana cost. And then its power and toughness are equal to 1+ number of lands you control. So for 2 green, boom, exile, cast a 7 drop.
Cascade.
Probably to a 6 drop, right?
Hopefully. I mean,
you can also build your deck so that when you cast Emoti, because it's a 5 drop, it casts a guaranteed spell that's 4 and down. But I don't,
probably don't want to do that because then you can't have any 3s or 2s in your deck.
Yeah.
Commandeer is similar. It's an instant for 5 blue, but you can exile 2 blue cards from your hand rather than pay its mana cost.
Okay, cool.
It gains control of creature or permanent? A non-creature spell.
Yeah. So you could
choose new targets for the spell.
You could get like someone casting a dig through time even.
Yeah. You hijack a spell, you cascade. Seems good.
And then there are all the traps. So Cobra Trap and Summoning Trap are 6 mana, but they allow you to
cast them for cheaper
if something happens. Like a permanent you control, non-creature was destroyed, you can cast it. You get a bunch of snake tokens for the first one. And then for Summoning Trap, you get to look at the top 7 cards of your library and cheat one out onto the battlefield if a creature was countered by a spell or ability an opponent controlled.
That one's meta-dependent, but it's a way to cast a high CMC spell for cheap.
And it's instant, too.
Yep. Then there's mechanics that do this. So Undaunted is a mechanic that the spell costs 1 less to cast for each opponent.
But the CMC remains the same.
Yeah, so Coastal Breach is 7 mana, but if you have 3 opponents, it would only be 4 mana, and that returns all non-land permanents to their owner's hand. And then there's Delve cards, which Treasure Cruise, Dig Through Time, Logic Knot, Temporal Trespass. These are high CMC spells, but you can exile cards from your graveyard to pay for part of the mana cost. So again, it costs 8, but you only pay 2. And then it triggers Cascade when you do it.
Yep. Miracle also is a way to cast a spell for a slightly lesser cost.
A lot lesser, usually.
Yeah, so like there's cards like Revenge of the Hunted, Temporal Mastery. Their CMC is much higher than their Miracle cost.
Yep. And then, you know, high CMC extra turn cards are going to be really good because you get the extra value of cascading.
And a turn.
Yeah, and extra turn cards obviously always good and not something everybody wants to play. But they're going to be powerful because you're like, cast Nexus of Fate, cascade into something, now untap.
And use that thing.
Yeah, and a lot of times Nexus of Fate, not that great if you've only got 7 mana.
Yeah, a lot of people just play it, draw a card.
Draw a card and get an extra land drop, right? That's really what you get out of it. But in this case, you get a cascade trigger, so that's like, makes them pretty good. So
cool.
Nexus of Fate, Part the Water Veil, Expropriate, Time Stretch. You want the ones, obviously, they're 6 CMC or more. Because then you're going to cast another 6 CMC spell.
Right.
And, you know, cascade again and really get that value train going.
Cool.
So
does sound like a value train.
Yeah, it's Simic again, so it's going to be good. It's going to be strong. You don't have to do the extra turns thing if that's not what your playgroup's into.
Yeah, and you can just play this, and again, a deck like Animar, again, has a lot of 6 CMC spells or higher. And so you can just pay this for blue and a green, and then boom, cascade all over the place.
All right, that's going to do it. That's all 16 of the commanders we had remaining. So we've covered all 32 of the solo commanders. Next up, we're going to be talking about the partner commanders, probably in a two-part series. We're probably going to split that in half because
there's way too many
or something. So to the listeners, what do you think of our second batch of solo commander legends? Is there any interactions, combos, synergies that you think we missed?
The perfect commander to put one of these in, let us know.
Obviously, we can't talk about everything, and we don't come up with everything, so we might have missed something. Please put it in the comments so that other people can see what other people have come up with.
Yeah. And when you come up with those things and see those awesome suggestions that are better than ours, Well, why don't you take our suggestion to go to cardgame.com/commandzone and purchase those cards. Get the cards you need to make the decks right now. Commander Legends is right on the horizon, or it's already out, depending on when you're watching this.
It's on the horizon.
Yeah, you're going to want to buy the booster packs if you want to draft it, and there will be a time when it's safe to draft within the stores, and I guarantee you that Josh and I will be there with packs in hand.
I mean, it could be far enough off that Commander Legends is in the past, but I hope it's not.
Yeah, and you know what? We still talk about occasionally trying to get a conspiracy draft and stuff together, but yeah. Commander Legends feels like a draft format that we could be playing for a long time.
We're definitely going to keep a few booster boxes in the corner for when it's safe to draft after the pandemic is over, and yeah. I don't care when that is. That could be 2022. We're going to do it.
Of course.
Yeah.
And you might, you know, maybe you want to build a cube. And if you want to do all that stuff, Card Kingdom has you covered. CardKingdom.com/commandzone. They've got great customer service. They also have an amazing buyback program. So if you're looking to trade in some old cards for some of these new staples, do it. They're amazing and they work really quickly and efficiently.
Look into Araumi. That's a cool deck. I would think about building that one if you're not sure. And then once you get all the cards, you want to protect them. You want to make sure that they're in safe and secure in a nice UltraPro Eclipse sleeve. You want to play them onto an UltraPro playmat. You want to make sure that your entire deck is safe into an UltraPro maybe Satin Tower deck box, or maybe one of their new cool classy looking Mythic Collection deck boxes.
Ooh.
Yeah, I really like those.
I like
those. Send
too.
Us some more because we give all that stuff away, so I don't actually have one right now. But
or and big thanks to UltraPro for having that forward thinking, right? They've been with us for a few years now and they've given away, you know, I looked at our list. We've done what, how many game nights?
40. I think the next one's the 40th one, and they've been giving away stuff on that since like fifth or sixth episode.
Yeah, so that's 35 times five. We've sent over 150 packages for just UltraPro out to our listeners.
It's tens of thousands of dollars worth of stuff for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. All right, we're gonna skip the end step today because this is a bonus episode. We got a lot of content coming at you, and we don't have enough cool things in our life to talk about on end steps for all of them.
Correct.
But we can talk about some cool people.
Yeah.
Our editing, graphics, and logistics team, Ashlyn Rose, Kate Blanchett. Craig Blanchett, Lady Danger, Manson Lung, Justin Masseth, he's new here and I'm sure was working on this episode, Jake Boss, Josh Murphy, Alfred Estaca, Patrick Nunn, and Sam Waldo.
Thanks for all their help. And of course, big thanks, Jeffrey Palmer. As always, Living Card Animations that often live behind us on set and begin our show at youtube.com/commandzonepodcast. Find Jeffrey, send him some love at Living Cards MTG. Maybe he's done some Commander Legends animations. Who knows?
All right, everybody. Thanks for watching. We'll see you very, very soon. I almost hit where the other camera would have been.
Let's not play baseball.
Peace.
Thank you for your attention. For further inquiries, send an email to commandcast@rocketjump.com. Or ask us on Twitter at JF Wong and at Josh Lee Kwai. See you later, alligator.
Greetings, humans.